Good morning and a warm welcome to our viewers for our second APSA Art Hotspot for 2023. A special shout out to our APSA colleagues, suppliers and partners, not just from South Africa, but from across Africa that are tuning in. It is so wonderful to have each of you joining us this morning. As the APSA Gallery, we are very excited to launch today the solo exhibition of Pokan and Yonkon, our 2019 APSA Atelier Gerald Sokoto winner. He is joining me this morning in the gallery to share his journey since winning that award in 2019 and to share his inspiration behind his solo exhibition. Welcome, Poka.
Thank you so much, Paul, for having me here today. I really appreciate this opportunity and, of course, to have this exhibition in this great space. Yeah, thank you so much. I appreciate that.
I mean, I'm so excited. I mean, we've been working on this for, well, I haven't. You've been working on this. I mean, I can't take credit for that, but you've been working on this for, you know, a long time, many, many months. So what does it actually feel like for you to be having your solo exhibition now?
Look, as I said, Paul, like, first of all, like, it's, you know, I feel really grateful to have this opportunity. You know, it's been quite a while that I haven't had, like, you know, never mind, like, a solo exhibition, you know, because, like, I've had to focus on other things, you know, like, you know, my academics and stuff like that. So to have this solo exhibition is actually, like, you know, like, quite a good feeling, like, and it's, you know, and a reaffirmation that, like, you know, my work is still, like, you know, relevant, you know, in the wider, you know, scheme of things, you know.
And it is relevant. I mean, we're going to get to that point later on when we talk in more detail around the work and to actually see it, you know, on the wall, in the space. I mean, it really is, I mean, it's fabulous. I mean,
thank you.
It Thanks. Really is. So, well done.
Thank
well
you, Paul. Done. Thanks.
Now, you won the Absa Latilea Gerald Sokoto Award in 2019. I mean, that seems a long time ago. A lot has happened in that time. But, you know, share with us, you know, what went through your mind at that time when, you know, we were in Cape Town at a live event. How did you feel? You know, what went through your mind?
Look, I mean, as you do mention, like, we were in Cape Town. I recall I was still, you know, in my studies, like, studying towards an honors degree, you know. So actually Cape Town was still quite new to me, you know, that whole year, you know. And I'd been going through some personal stuff, you know. Not really pleasant, but, like, you know, it was part of the whole experience. So to actually, you know, discover that, like, you know, I've actually been chosen for the Gerald Sokoto Latilea Award, like, became like this, like, surreal, you know, all of a sudden, like, jump from, like, one space mentally, psychologically, and to a totally different space where I actually had to really, like, you know, dip into my, you know, emotions and, like, really, you know, let it sink in and, like, you know, appreciate the whole moment. You know, I couldn't, really locate or situate, like, my feelings at that time. It was just, like, surreal. But it was really, like, a great feeling to know that, like, you know, I'm actually being, you know, recognized for my work, you know. And, you know, since that day, I had always felt like, you know, I mean, my work does actually count for something, you know, because, like, there's a lot of art being produced out here, you know. So to actually get the go-ahead and the nod from one of the, like, esteemed, highly esteemed prizes, not just in South Africa, but in Africa, like, was really, like, you know, a feather in my cap, you know, so to speak. So I was really excited about that.
And you were studying, you said, so you were studying at UCT?
Yes, of course, yeah, I was.
And where, I mean, you were doing your master's, your honors, your, at
yeah,
that time?
Yeah. So I was actually, like, it was my first year in Cape Town at UCT,
okay,
doing my honors, you know, in curatorship, yes, studies, you know. So, yeah, I had arrived that year, so I was studying towards my honors in curatorship.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was a whole new, different, you know, experience for me, having had, you know, studied in Pretoria, yes, and then moving there. You know, it was like a totally different experience. Like, and also, as I say, the award itself, like, you know, totally, like, put a spin on, like, everything. Like, I had to really, like, you know,
but
start understanding myself in a different
spin,
light.
I hope.
Yeah, no, yeah. Look, it was definitely a positive, like, mm-hmm, you know, an amazing and exciting time for me, yeah.
So, I mean, and as I said, you know, 2019, since then a lot had happened. COVID, shortly after that,
we entered
the COVID pandemic. How did that actually have an impact on you in terms of, as Poca, in terms of your studies, your career, and things like that?
Look, of course, I mean, there was, like, quite a, you know, highly disruptive time to start with, like, you know, at university itself, not just, like, at UCT, of course, but, like, the country over, like, in the world over, like, studies had to be, you know, totally, like, overhauled, you know, and, like, you know, we had to actually, like, even go back home to actually start, like, working online digitally. So it was an uprooting of sorts, you know, like, you kind of, like, starting to settle in, you know, into a place and, like, also, like, focusing into your studies. All of a sudden, there's this, like, you know, crisis that comes and just disrupts everything.
And also your plans. I mean, if I recall, I mean, you and I at that time had to have a very sort of difficult telephone discussion. I remember that, you know, where you were almost at the time getting ready to take up your part of your ward to go to Paris.
Yeah.
For the residency, and we had to almost have that discussion to say, well, unfortunately, it's not going to happen.
Yeah, look, I mean, I think the answer to the question of, like, how did that impact me, like, I think the most, you know, clear, you know, and obvious, like, impact was the me not being able to take up my residency, you know, because, you know, I think, you know, anyone who knows anything about, like, the Absa Latilea Award, especially the Karatsukoto Award, would know that like one of the things that you look forward to is actually taking up residence in Paris, you know.
Correct,
so for one to not have, you know, that opportunity, you know, it's actually obviously like, you know, highly disappointing. Yeah. But at the same time, you know, it doesn't happen in a vacuum. Obviously, like it's not just yourself that doesn't, you know, get to take up the opportunities.
We were all impacted. Correct.
So, you know, it there was a context, you know, that you could work with as a person, but also as an artist to say that, like, look, I mean, I have to face up to these things. They do happen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and of course, later on, I was lucky enough to take up the Nairox, you know, foundation residency, which is still, like, quite a big thing for me.
And, I mean, you spent, you know, 2 months at Nairox. For me, as a curator in that, it was, you know, one of the pleasures of, you know, being able to have spent time with you there, seeing the production of the work that you've produced, you know, that has brought together, you know, this fabulous exhibition. And I suppose that's also one of the challenges, you know, in pulling together a bit of a solo is you not just working on a single artwork or two or three, you're now having to almost, while you're at Nairox, work on a body of winning artworks, if I can call it as such.
I think it's for an artist to actually work in a residency is always quite exciting. There are, you know, some you know, moments of being, you know, uncertainty actually, because you never know what will come out of your time there. You know, you might spend the 2 months there and only maybe perhaps produce like 5 works. But of course, like working in the professional sort of space, you know, there's a drive to see things through, you know, the fruition of things, you know. Like you walk into an exhibition, walk into a residency rather, and then you know that you actually have to be productive, not just like the actual production of artworks, but also like mentally and being in the space conceptually. So for me, it was like a new experience, you know. I had always, by the way, like, you know, had this like wish to go to Nairox because like quite a few friends of mine, you know, who are successful in their own rise today have passed through that residency. So me getting a chance to go there was actually like quite a big thing for me.
Look, it's a fantastic space, the Nairox Sculpture Park. And let me just do a bit of a shout out to the team there, to Benji and the team. And, you know, if you do have that opportunity, it's just outside Johannesburg. If, you know, on a weekend, go through and walk through that space. Some fantastic sculptures there and so on. And really, you just clear your mind. It's absolutely wonderful. But let's bring it back to you. And you didn't just produce a few works. While you were there for those 2 months, you produced really a fantastic body of work. And let us now just take a bit of a fly through of this exhibition in the APSA Gallery to see some of the amazing artwork that you produced there.
Thank you.
Absolutely fantastic, Poca. I mean, congratulations. Wonderful works. One thing I noticed, you know, and I think just sitting in the space, you can see some of the works behind us as well, is that you're working at an incredibly large scale in the majority of the works. Is this something you purposely did for this particular exhibition?
Yeah, so if you look at the artist statement, it makes mention, but also the conceptual sort of like sort of position that I took, is that the a large part of the work conceptually is inspired by like sort of Western classical, like, you know, paintings.
Yes.
So and scale was part of like, you know, the ideas and the presentation of the artist. So I mean, like, there are works that, you know, if you don't actually make the right choices in terms of scale, I mean, you might have like a good image or aesthetic, but if you actually don't make the choice to match, you know, and actually really well considered choice to tween the content, so the aesthetic with the scale that you want, I think sometimes you might miss something. So scale is really important to me, like in terms of like really like going for it and not holding anything back.
Well, you didn't. I mean, you clearly did not hold back, and I must compliment you on that. And I think what you've said is so important, because had you worked, you know, looking at the detail within the work, if you worked on a smaller scale, a lot of that would be lost to the viewer.
Absolutely, yeah. No, it would be lost, you know, and I think, you know, that's why, I mean, it's important to, again, the question of the residency comes into question here, you know. Sometimes you're just working in your home studio or your normal everyday studio, and then you kind of, like, become complacent or just relaxed and too comfortable, you know, just, you know, kind of, like, working. But, like, in a residency, that's where you kind of, like, you know, think to yourself that, like, you know, I've always yearned or wanted to make things in a certain way. So this is, if not now, you know, in residency, you know, let me just go for it. So
allowed that opportunity to do so, and that open space that you had at Nairox.
Yeah, you know, absolutely amazing. You know, like, you know, the setting there, the atmosphere, you know, and also the physical space, as you say, like,
yes,
it all makes up for like a really good space to kind of just like explore and go for things.
So just share with us, but we are going to come back to the exhibition and the artworks herein. But just share with us a bit of who is Poca? You know, where were you born? Do you have any siblings?
Yeah, so Poca is a son, you know, it's a brother, it's a you know, a nephew, an uncle, you know, a father. And I was actually born in Volmar Randstad in the Northwest, you know. And then, like, you know, not, you know, long after that, my family actually decided to move just down the road on the highway, the N12 highway, down to Klerksdorp, which is where I grew up, actually.
Okay.
You know, I might have been like around 4 years or 5 years old, you know, but I actually like spent most of my childhood in, you know, Klerksdorp, rather than in Volmar Randstad, where I was born. But on the whole, I grew up in Northwest Province, you know, and I do have siblings, which is an interesting question in the sense that, like, that's how I was introduced to art, you know, through my siblings' love of drawing.
Okay.
And when I say drawing, I mean some serious drawing, you know. This was not just some, you know, scribbling by these guys, you know. Two of my brothers, they were actually quite rooted in their drawing practices. Of course, at the time, there was not any thinking, I guess, on their part about, you know, progressing to being professional artists. But, like, I grew up under the influence of seeing them draw. But at some point, also, there was the introduction to clay, you know, village to kind of, like, do some small-scale mining of some clay there, you know, unpurified clay, of course, and then they would bring it to back to the townships and would make clay oxen and, you know, figures and stuff like that. So, yeah, I mean, that was, like, sort of, like, my introduction, a very early, like, introduction, you know, of course, like, resulting in a very naive sort of like approach to art and
so,
making.
So what are your siblings now say? I mean, they, as you said, they draw very well in that. But you've now become a professional artist. I mean, how are they finding your journey that you've now taken?
I mean, I think, you know, it's been like, we don't talk about it a lot, but when we have spoken about it, like, it's the conversation is one of like sort of like them being quite like inspired and like wowed that like I was actually able to take up this baton and run with it, you know. And that, you know, when they used to draw, they do make mention of this, that when they used to draw, they never actually thought that like it would have any impact on myself, you know. So years later now, when I do actually reveal to them that I was always inspired by their drawings and their work, you know, it's for them, it's quite astounding, and they like they actually, it's unbelievable for them that I was even aware of that.
I mean, I love that story, because so often, you know, when we speak to artists and that, and you ask where does the inspiration come from and so on, they mention, you know, they knew an artist or someone in a related family or, you know, a distant cousin. Yeah. But yeah, you had someone who wasn't actually an artist, but who actually had the ability and the talent and inspired you to take up the passion that you've now got.
Definitely. I think they, even myself, I sort of like sometimes don't actually realize the gravity of that that story, you know. But when I do think about it, take a moment and think about it, I actually really do appreciate the fact that I was born at that time in that setting, in that family, you know, because I mean, I think it, not a lot of people will can say that they grew up under that kind of like influence in that kind of setting.
But having now progressed as an artist, you know, having studied, what are some of the challenges that you've had to overcome?
First of all, the art market, the art market, but not just the market, the practice itself, you know, tends to be quite intimidating, you know, because it's so saturated, you know, with hopefuls and people who've already actually made it, you know. So the challenge is, like, for me, it's always just getting, like, someone to notice you and actually give you attention, just to take a look at your work, you know. But also the challenge is more internal, you know, it's quite personal. Do you believe in what you're doing, you know? Are you able to sort of, like, slug it out and, like, really push on to you know, realize your dream, if it's your dream and your passion. And I think in that sense, like it, the secret lies in just like enjoying making work, not for anyone else but yourself.
I think that's so important, because one of the things as an artist is you put in almost the blood, sweat and tears into your artwork. You're putting it out there for people to look at, and at the same time, people to criticize. Yeah. Because they do, sometimes it might be complimentary, sometimes the comments coming back might not be. And you can't let that affect you in terms of your journey.
Yeah.
You have to have that internal belief in your own ability.
Yeah, I think often like those conversations, like the answers, they might lie, they lie in different like sort of like directions. Like, but part of like the importance of art school comes in there, you know, for one to go to art. I mean, I know like not anyone is meant to go to art school, you know. It's not art school is not meant for everyone. But the space allows for critique, you know. Like you being in a space whereby that where there's a, you know, a lot of like talented people who can draw better than yourself, or you can paint better than the other person, then the exchange of like critique and, you know, like the awareness of what people are creating and why are they creating what they are doing. It's really important in this sense.
And you've got, and you developed some mentors at university and so on that helped guide you and so on.
Yeah, you do. I mean, that's why, like, you know, so art school becomes a community, you know, that, and also it becomes like an extension of the art world, you know, where like it's a kind of a sanctuary where you like you're able to kind of like build yourself up, so that when you go out there, you know, you would have all, had all this assortment of experiences, and then like you can take it out there with.
So we should be giving a shout out to both your lecturers and that, both in Pretoria in Shwane. It was TUT, Shwane
TUT,
TUT, and we've had a number of Gerald Sokoto winners that have come out of TUT. So they're definitely a legacy. Coming from that to the team there, and also to the team at UCT. So a big shout out to the lecturers.
I feel really privileged to have come from this long line, as you say, of artists who have actually like made it to the, you know, through the Absalatile Awards, because, you know, it just shows you that like the people there who teach there are actually in like esteemed themselves, you know, because then they do impart this like rich tradition of like, you know, art practice onto us. So I really like give a shout out as well to them.
Fantastic. Big shout out to them. Can you just really describe your voice and your style?
Look, I mean, my style is, Paul, that's quite like, you know, that could take the whole day to talk about. Because my style is quite like, I mean, I don't know, quite eclectic. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a collection of this, like, and that's deliberate, by the way. You know, in that, like, my style is figurative, first of all, you know, and again, deliberate.
Yeah.
You know, so, because figuration is like a really long history. So I play around with that. You know, my voice is like, I'm not really looking when I make work to discover anything new. I think for me, what is important is the awareness of like, what can I achieve within the picture, within the work itself, you know, connected, of course, to the issues that I'm trying to express. But like, yeah, figuration, you know, I don't want to call it expression, expressive figuration or what, but like, yeah.
You don't want to box it.
Of course. I mean, I think one take that is interesting to me, not a take, but just a descriptive sort of like, maybe term, is like, I look at my work as like a history painting. Mm. So I focus on history. You know, I don't paint contemporary subjects as such, you know. But of course, you would see that like the ideas and the concept speaks to what's happening in the contemporary world. Yeah. But the actual approach to the painting is premised on like history painting as a genre.
For me, it's almost that cultural heritage aspect that comes through, you know, and that talks to me being myself as an art curator, but also responsible for the Absamani Museum and so on. So it's that you're crossing that, you know, from the artifacts and that are reflected, particularly in this body of work within the artworks, and that historical narrative that comes through.
Yeah, because I mean that culture and heritage is also mostly like, you know, taken is led by the conceptual sort of like angle that I take on the work, you know, and then combine that with the historical sort of like position that I take as a painter, you know, not so much as a thinker, but like, well, of course, I mean, I guess as a thinker, I'm really concerned as well about like, you know, how do I look at history painting? How do we collectively look at it? You know, does it still have, you know, space in this like current conversations? So yeah, I mean, I think like there's a twinning or, you know, a coming together of like the cultural heritage and then concern with like history painting per se.
Well, look, let's take a cutaway and we're going to delve a bit more in looking at the views of Poka.
My name is Poka Nyokong. I was born and bred in the Northwest Province. I was lucky enough to be chosen as the winner of the Gerard Sekoto Award in 2019, which was, of course, an honor and a privilege for me. You know, you get a chance to take up residence in Paris, in France, at the Cité Studios. So I grew up like focusing on painting and drawing. You know, but like later on in my practice, I kind of like started gravitating towards many various forms of art making. For instance, like the writing and the performing, the performance art kind of like part of it. So, you know, I mean, of course, we would know all of us by now that like, you know, 2020 happened and like there was like all this, you know, crisis with the pandemic. And as a result, I couldn't take up my prize, like, you know, with the residency in France. I, you know, later on, like, you know, APSA offered me a chance to go and like take up residency at Nairobi Sculpture Park here in Gauteng. I think it was kind of like a blessing in disguise of sorts. I had always like, you know, had a dream to go and like also like work in Nairobi Sculpture Park. So for me, like kind of like incorporating all of these art forms, it's like kind of like, you know, conducting an inquiry into like who we are as a culture and a people, but also as a generation. I'm a human being, I'm an uncle, I'm a father, I'm a son, you know, I'm a humanist.
So now this particular exhibition has a very interesting title to it, and I'm as I was practicing and running through it, I tended to jumble the words up, so I'm going to just hopefully don't get it completely wrong now, Poka, so please bear with me. It is entitled Museum of the New Hymns for the Confused. please enlighten us. What does this mean?
Okay, yeah. I mean, I also think it's quite a, quite an unusual, maybe title. So I look at the exhibition itself, not really the physical gallery right now, but the exhibition, the body of works, as a museum, So it's a conceptual kind of or even a theoretical museum, in that the paintings themselves, they kind of house these objects that I'm preoccupied with, So each painting, you look at it and encounter these objects that if one has read anything on West African art and the Beninese bronzes, then you would sort of recognize that. And we all know that there's been a topical conversation around the world, regarding this objects. So the museum for me, it's the body of work, and the hymns, is sort of suggesting a kind of a homage, to this object. But you will see some artworks are dedicated to certain individuals. Mm. For example, the artist, South African artist Charles Nkosi. There's an artwork dedicated to Charles Nkosi. There's one dedicated to the late South African novelist Casey Lodeker, which are the portraits there. So, I mean, the confused just refers to a collective sort of thinking, loosely, that after the emergence from the pandemic, there was, but also during the pandemic, there was a confusion of sorts, of course, around the world, So, I mean, I'm sort of trying to compose new hymns for us, the confused, or perhaps the ones confused, So. Within this,
and bring in life, because often we look at museums and we think them almost as dead spaces. But when you, as you mentioned the word hymns within that same sentence, you almost bring in life to these spaces as well in that sense.
Definitely, and especially the extension to say new hymns,
Correct.
It's a renewal of sorts, if you think about it. So, yeah, I think, and you're quite right about this. Museums tend to be quite contentious in our eyes, and especially practitioners of art and culture. But I think, this is where it could start, in some spaces, this kind of exhibition, It's simply just to not give answers, but just to initiate conversations, and questions in some corners.
That is so important. I mean, I love that. And as we were walking through earlier, it's that initiation of the dialogue that these works actually create with one. Can you share with us a bit of your methodology in preparing for this exhibition?
Beginning in 2020, I embarked on a body of works titled Ethnology for Genocide, the History Paintings. So simply the methodology for this current body of works was just an extension of the thinking that was initiated in that, initial body of works in this, series of works. So methodology is not too complex or too academic, not a whole lot of research, because I watch a lot of YouTube videos on West African art and museums and stuff like that. So simply just consuming these images from the videos and later on, maybe at the time you're not feeling working, all of a sudden later on, I take out my blank paper and I start scribbling with a pastel and stuff like that. So really basic, and really organic in terms of the approach to making the work.
We've got a lot of artists, Poka, that are watching. And one of the questions I know that they would be asking, and it often comes up in conversation that I would have with them, is what does it take to prepare for a solo exhibition?
I think, it takes a whole lot of things. Certain things, it definitely takes your kind of the internal and the personal. In that, I think you have to be situated and really, in the moment of wanting to have the work, wanting to have the solo exhibition, because it won't be of any use that you're making a show because you've gotten an award, but you're not actually mentally in the space to make the work. So I think what it takes is simply an excitement, and looking forward, and having, content and having concepts and, of course, having material like this immaterial itself, no pun intended. But, I mean, you've got to you know, have the passion and the vision to want to make it work.
Do you have an idea of where you want to go, or do you have a sense of this is where conceptually I think we go in, and as you produce that work, that vision and that end product becomes clearer?
In my case, I often don't have like a vision for an ending or an end result. You know, I just like sort of like allow myself to go along and just keep making work.
And almost be swept up in that moment of
it. Be swept up in amongst like the ideas, yes, and like the excitement of actually like putting pastel to paper or brush to canvas, you know. And then, you know, just simply like, you know, allowing the conceptual sort of like underpinnings to grow from within there, to image, like, you know, with this body of work, certainly by the third artwork, yeah, you know, for me, you know, I start developing like a bit of an idea of like where this might lead me, you know, in terms of like the connecting the body of work.
So to the artists that are watching, in other words, don't procrastinate. Don't try to think it all out in the beginning. Dive into it and start the journey, and as you start it, allow it to evolve along the way.
Absolutely, start working, you know. Mm. As I say, you know, I mean, I was saying just a bit earlier on now that, like, the thing is, like, whether you have materials in your studio, yeah, or in residency, you won't work, or at least you won't enjoy work if it's not something that haunts you, that, yes, you keep thinking, yeah, about. So, I mean, thinking about things a lot, about what you want to do, how you want that portrait, it's actually not making work, yeah, you know. You know, I think, you know, the thinking should take place through working, through actually painting, and that's when you're actually making the thinking.
And back to the solo exhibition question, do you work on one work or multiple works simultaneously?
I definitely work on multiple works, you know. Mm. And it's funny that, like, the works behind us, like, how they are set up in the gallery as you enter, they actually unfolded like that in the residency, you know. So I started with the work at the far...
On that side, yes.
On that side. And then the work in the right in the middle, okay, was the second work to take place.
And then the one behind
yourself, you know.
Absolutely,
so,
fantastic.
Yeah, I'm always, like, at all times working on multiple works. I can't, you know, work on one work. It's something that I can't just, like, you know, I just can't, like, do.
And the impact of winning the Absolutely Gerald Sokoto Award, what has that had on you?
It has, like, made me realize that, like, you know, I have a bigger kind of, like, obligation to myself to make work. Because if you could be recognized for your work, then it means you have so much to offer. So it makes you sort of, like, realize, it helps to situate you in a certain space that you have moved from one space as a practitioner to another level or to a certain space, you know. And, you know, you have a sort of like a certain different view from yourself, from what you used to, how you used to view yourself, you know, and the reasons you're making work, perhaps.
And you're part of as we've mentioned, you're part of a legacy. I mean, as an Absolutely Gerald Sokoto winner, you know, you think of the partnership that we have with SANAVA, the South African National Association for the Visual Arts, you know, a partnership with... IFAS as well, you know, that are actually the main, and the French Embassy in South Africa, which are the main sponsors of the Gerald Sokoto Award. So, I mean, they've been involved with this award for 20 years, so you really are part of a legacy and of champions that have come through this over two decades.
Yeah, and look, before you even, and I think I'd be talking for some artists as well, yeah, that I know that I grew up with at art school, that, like, you know, before you even, like, get to enter the competition itself, we've always read about the, you know.
Only I had, you know, when we were listening to the APSA Art Hotspot on the 20th of April in 2023, I purchased one of Pocker's artworks because he is going places, I do say that. And as a gallery, we take no commission. All the proceeds from the sale of these works do go to the artist and do continue to support him. So please do invest in our young and future talent that we have in South Africa and on this continent. If you want to see more of this exhibition, we do have a meet and greet tomorrow with Pocker in the APSA Gallery. It's from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock. Come through if you are around in Johannesburg. We would love to have you. Come have a cup of coffee. Join myself, that's the gallery team, and Poca, allow him to take you through this absolutely fantastic, fantastic exhibition. And I can say, if you can't make it this week, the exhibition will be on until the 1st of June. Just also note, the gallery is open from Monday through till Friday, so anytime business hours, come in. But that's not all, because as part of winning the Atelier Gerald Sokota Award, this exhibition will travel. So we'd also aware that you can't always get here. The exhibition is going to Quebec later in August, and then thereafter it is going through to Shawane in October. So you also will have an opportunity to see these fantastic works. Please also just keep an eye out on our social media platforms for more information around this traveling show. So, to everyone that has joined us today, a big, big thank you. And I look forward to seeing some of you in the APSA Gallery here in Johannesburg. To Poca, well done. Congratulations. It is a phenomenal, phenomenal show and some fantastic works therein. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks. I appreciate that.
Until our next art, APSA Art Hotspot, we look forward to hosting you in the APSA Gallery to view Poca's exhibition. So now, Poca, I think we've done enough talking. Let's do what I love to do as an art curator. Let's get up and let's go further explore these works. Come, we can't sit here any longer.